Meanwhile, here is another linguist whom I admire, and my friend, Dr. Joshua Nash. Hello, Josh.
Hi, Peter.
And our mutual friend, Jason Sweeney, the eminent composer and sometime filmmaker, is here making a film of this, of us speaking.
Indeed, because you've become an extremely important part of this intellectual, spatial and linguistic adventuring.
While several scholars have come to work on the language of the descendants of the Bounty mutineers with its Polynesian influence, they were never linguists when they arrived. They took data, studied semblance of linguistic science at home, wrote what they did. The principal writers were Ross and Moverley in the early 1950s and Kelgore in the 1980s. Unfortunately, the morsels they published have left linguists, in this case me, hungry and wanting. No choice. I had to go.
You're a linguist.
I'm a linguist. I'm trained as a linguist. I did my undergrad in psychology. I moved into environmental studies. Cut a long story short, I then became a, on paper, I'm a professional linguist. Yes, I did my PhD in the linguistics of place naming on Norfolk Island and Kangaroo Island, specifically the Dudley Peninsula, the easternmost part of Kangaroo Island.
On which you have published.
Which I've published quite broadly, yes.
Is this toponymy?
Toponymy, yes. Toponym, place name.
Yes. Which is endlessly fascinating.
Yeah, and Pitcairn Island itself is probably, I could say, and I'm not unbiased, it's probably one of the most fascinating specks of land in on the planet as far as toponymy, place naming is concerned. It's got many layers, place after place, history, stories about people crapping on each other's heads and falling off cliffs and the rest. And, well, you know, you were there for...
You were there 3 months.
May 20th we arrived, we meaning Joshua, Holly and Olive.
Yes.
And we left on the 21st of August, so it was well and truly 3 long months.
How did you become a linguist?
My story with linguistics, Peter, goes back to studying environmental studies. And then I took a course in 99 within this environmental studies master's that I did called, that course was called environmental linguistics or eco-linguistics. I did that with Professor Peter Mühlhäuser, who's now emeritus professor at the University of Adelaide. I took a liking to this membrane which language offers into understanding the environment and the membrane which the environment offers to understanding language. To cut a long story short, in 2007, I was invited by my master's supervisor, Peter Mühlhäuser, to travel to Norfolk Island as his research assistant, which then became a bit of a, an opportunity to open up a PhD in the language of Norfolk Island, specifically
Norfolk, yes.
The Norfolk language.
My guest, Dr. Joshua Nash, linguist. Now, at some point in the 19th century, Pitcairn had the population had grown exponentially to well over 300, I think.
No, it wasn't as high as that. I thought it was, wasn't it? I can't remember the stats, Peter. I think it was 220, 230, was maybe it? 250,
but
something.
It was decided that it was unsupportable because it's a very small island.
That's right.
It's
5 square kilometres.
Exactly. And rock.
Rock.
Volcanic rock. So it was decided that they'd be the mutineer, the descendants of the mutineers would be moved off to Norfolk Island. It had ceased to be a penal colony. Let's put them there.
That's right.
They all went. However, some decided to leave and go back to Pitcairn, which they did. So you now have two sets, Norfolk and Pitcairn.
I was and am the first professional linguist ever to have set foot on the island. I doubt another linguist or ethnographer or similar will go while I'm still alive. And specifically, I'm the only scholar to have initiated anything verging on a linguistic project on this especial language in more than 3 decades. I collected the data and local knowledge language contact scholars wish for and require, a way of speaking which seems to resist classification using the present apparatus available to linguistic typologists, that is, those scholars who divide up languages into groups according to types such as pidgin, Creole, or mixed language. I am carrying the torch of the future of research into the Pitcairn language.
There are lots of features, which was part of my job to look at when I was on Pitcairn Island. You know, what features were the same, what features are different, what ways do they have of talking about people, place, space, and the rest. There seems to be several features that are distinct to Pitcairn Island, the way they use certain, as I said, spatial axes to talk about, say, relationship between, say, where you are in the room and where I am in the room, upside, downside, which doesn't occur on Norfolk Island.
Upside, downside.
Yeah.
So which is upside, which is downside?
Upside is the side towards the highest point or the southern side of the island, and the downside axis is the north coast side.
Like Ted's side.
Yes.
It's downside.
No. Oh. It's actually not as simple as that. Ted's side is the other side of the island. That is that Ted's is down.
Side. Yeah.
Excuse me, but Ted's side... It's complicated. The point that I'm making is that there seems to be these distinct ways of talking about space on Pitcairn Island, in Pitcairn, which don't exist on Norfolk Island.
And I'm fascinated by this because as the world is, because it's the sense of utopia lost.
Right.
Always, isn't it, with looking at this, that what could have been a utopia and was intended as an accidental utopia, what has become of it? And because it's so small and the population is so small, we can look at it. It's not like a huge society, so it's easy to look at. And what fascinates me about this is not just the bounty story, which has fascinated the world for centuries, but you have these people... who arrive there, so you lift the lid all these years later, and what's happened?
What does
it look like? Is that language in danger?
Of course it is. Mm-hmm. I don't believe it's... I mean, some of Nola's husband is passed away, Ranald Warren.
Yes.
God bless him. There are very few people that still speak that in sort of broad Pitcairn. There are very few, some of the young people who are on the island, they understand the language, but they don't really speak it. I don't know, but it doesn't look good. I mean, the general thing is if intergenerational transmission stops, that's generally the beginning
and
of the
you've
end.
Done more for it than any other writer, any other academic.
I can't say that that's the case, but I would say for sure that I'm in possession of the largest amount of recorded Pitcairn on the planet.